Good evening. I'm glad that we're back again. Today we're having an awesome study on what does love have to do with it. We're going to study about love. We're going to study about different kinds of love. And I want to first go through, last week, Cindy taught us on the awesomeness and the greatness of our Heavenly Father. And I did a little bit of a review on it. And when she was talking about the cherubims and the wings, I want to just give a little bit of review of that. But before I do that, I want to open up in prayer. Heavenly Father, I just thank you, Lord. Father God, for what you have to say to us tonight. Lord, we're learning and we're growing. Father, you're bringing out pearls and you're bringing out gold nuggets. And it's hidden in easy words. And we just read them and we just kind of just go through the motion and just read, and we're missing the nuggets, we're missing the diamonds, we're missing the pearls, we're missing them because we're just reading through and we're not really paying attention to what's underneath. What if when you open a pearl, what's inside is a beautiful pearl, but we're missing it because we are not understanding what you're saying. But through your Holy Spirit, be here tonight. Teach us. Open our eyes. Let us understand fully and thoroughly what it is you want us to hear today. Your word is so simple, and we just make it so difficult and so hard. But it is awesome. It is life to those that find it. Father God, I pray that each one here today, each one here is going to receive a pearl, a gold nugget, a diamond. They're going to receive something that they didn't have before. They're going to receive knowledge that they didn't have before. But most of all, they're going to receive understanding of that knowledge so that they can be able to apply it to their life. So, Holy Spirit, you're the true teacher. Come, take your place. Take your place. We are eager. We are hungry. We are ready to receive. We give you all the glory and the honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Are we ready? I am ready. I am ready because I've learned a few things. So, like I wanted to explain about the cherubim that was above the throne of God. And it said that it had six wings. Two of them covered their faces. The other covered the two covered the feet, and they were kind of covered. And I want to read to you what I understood of it. The wings, they are because the wings represent quick movement. And in heaven, it's not like here. It takes us a few seconds for me to walk down the aisle there. But in heaven, the thought, boom, it's there. I mean, instantly. So it's swift. It's real swift. And the wings are emblematic or symbolic of that, of the rigidity of it and the movement of it. So it represents that they're ready. They have readiness to move at his command. Just zoom at his command. And I just thought that that's how we're supposed to be ready. We're supposed to be ready that when he says something, let's do it. It doesn't matter if you're scared. It doesn't matter if you're trembling like I am right now. We're going to do it. Why are we going to do it? Because we love him. Why are we going to do it? Because we're obedient to him. It is not about us, like Sister prayed a while ago. It's all about him. So with the wings and the other two wings, it covered his face. And I'm going to tell you what all this really represents. Covering the face, covering the midsection and covering the feet. It, in similar description of the cherubim in Ezekiel 1:11, it is said they covered their bodies in Isaiah. The expression clearly denotes not the feet only. When you go before the presence of a king, and you notice that the king, when he goes before the public, he's dressed completely all the way down to his feet. They cover their entire body. Back, especially in that day, they felt very disrespectful if their feet shone, if their body shone. It was very disrespectful. So they were covered completely in form of reverence and respect. So in Isaiah, the expression clearly denotes that not the feet only was covered, but also the lower extremities. This was also an expression of reverence. The seraphim stood covered, or as if concealing themselves as much as possible, in token of their nothingness and worthiness in the presence of the Most High. Isn't that beautiful? Isn't that awesome? That they compared to what they were before. I mean, if His presence would fall in front of us right now, to me, when I was reading this and I was just praising Him, and His presence would fall in front of me, I would just feel so, I vanished. I vanished. Boom, gone. In comparedness to who He is. You understand what I'm saying? And that is how we're supposed to reverence Him. Not that we're worth nothing, because to Him, we are priceless. That's why He gave His most prized possession, because we're priceless to Him. But we, thinking of ourselves, should not think of us highly. We should think of us as we're not worthy to even be called. But he, because of His love, He called us. It is His love that draws us to Him. Isn't that awesome? So that's really what it was, the covering. And I also liked right here where it says in this commentary, to cover the face in this manner is the natural expression of reverence. And if the pure and holy seraphim show or manifest or display or demonstrate such reverence in the presence of Yahweh, with what profound awe and great respect should we who are polluted and sinful creatures, presume to draw near to Him? Most assuredly, their position should be reproved and rebuked to our presumption and belief or expectations when we rush thoughtlessly and irreverently into His presence. And should it teach us how, with lowly respect and reverence and deep humility, there, us seeing them and what they do and we what they do, should teach us, should rebuke us, should convict us of how we thoughtlessly just go into His presence. Yes, we are His children, but even when with your father and your mother, I don't know about these generations, but when I was young, I didn't disrespect my mom. When I would speak to my mom, I would call her usted. Not tú. Tú was disrespect. Tú is you. And I'm glad most of us understand here, Roberta, in our culture, tú is like equal, like a friend. But usted is respect. So we would honor them with that respect, and we would talk to them, we would talk with respect. Ama, ¿usted quiere un vaso de agua? I would say, Ama, ¿tú quieres un vaso de agua? Because saying tú is saying it to just anybody. And what I'm saying, Mom, would you like a glass of water? Or Mom, do you want a glass of water? It's do you. We don't use that in the elder. We respect the elders. So in that sense, today, when I see the total disrespect, I just cringe. It just, because I wasn't raised that way. But it should, the way that the angelic, if they that are greater than us, they're greater than us, if they reverence them like that, who are we that is near them? Yes, we are His children, and He wants us to go before Him boldly and without fear, but it doesn't say anything that says without respect. That's not in the Word of God. Amen? So, we are to see us in front of Him with reverence and honor. And sister, you did an awesome job in letting us know when we worship Him, remember who He is. He is God's sovereign, almighty, all-powerful. And that same one is coming back, and He's coming soon. In Revelation chapter 19, verses 11 through 16, in the New Living Translations, I picked these translations to read because they're simpler. And I know my heart is for young Christians that are growing, not the ones that are mature, the ones that think, okay, I heard it all, I know it all, No, I want the ones that are hungry, the ones that are humble. They're hungry, they want to learn, they want to grow, and they have a humble spirit. So that's why I am very, very simple. So I put very, very simple wording. So with that said, here I go. In verse 11, we're going to pick up that. In Revelation 19, verse 11. Then I saw heaven open, and a white horse was standing there. Its rider was named Faithful and True. For he judges fairly the wages and wages a righteous war. His eyes were like flames of fire, and on his head were many crowns. A name was written on him that no one understood except himself. He wore a robe dipped in blood, that's the blood of the saints. And his title was, look at what his title was, and his title was the Word of God. Ooh! His title is the Word of God. We have to have the Word of, we just should be filled with the Word of God. That's His title, the Word of God. So the Word of God means something, right? The Word of God should be important, right? The Word of God should be important, right? Amen. Are you awake or I already put you to sleep? The armies of heaven, he says, the armies of heaven, dressed in the finest pure white linen, followed him on the white horses. From his mouth came a sharp sword like to strike down the nations. He will rule them with an iron rod. He will release the fierce wrath of God, the Almighty, like juice flowing from the wine press. On his robe, at his thigh, was written this title, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He is coming soon to straighten out all this mess and put all things back in order. Why? Because Father loves us, and He doesn't want us to live this way. Amen? Now, that was a little review from last week. This week, why? Because He loves us. What does love have to do with it? What does love have to do with it? The ruler of this world doesn't respect love, nor does it want its inhabitants to respect it either. Why? Because it hates the Father. What is the Father? Love. The Father is love. Satan is hate. He hates the Father and everything that represents Him. So He hates us. Father is the ruler of heaven. Remember the fall of man in Genesis 3:15? I'm going to read it in the King James Version first. It says, and I remember when they had fallen, and then he had taken them, they were explaining, well, you know, the woman did this, and no, well, the woman said, well, the snake did this. And so he was passing out the curses, and he said, I will put enmity between, verse 15, I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. Now, let me put it in an easier translation. The same verse. I will make you and the woman enemies to each other. Your children and her children will be enemies. You will bite her child's foot. Who's her child's foot? Who's her child? Jesus. You will bite her child's foot. And what he's talking about there is that he was going to be crucified. But he will crush your head. Whoa. So, Satan was going to bite his heel, but Jesus is going to crush his head. Isn't that awesome? Now, according to the International Standard Bible Encyclopedia, enmity, the little clicker, if someone could bring it to me, please. Okay, in the meantime, in Encyclopedia, it says enmity, it means hate, murder, occurs as a translation of etha in Genesis 3:15. I will put enmity between thee and the woman and between thy seed and her seed. In other words, he was going to put hatred. Enmity means, thank you, Mija. Oh, I need to put this in there. Thank you. Enmity is remember what I said? It means rage, anger, hatred, passionate hatred. That's what enmity means. And when he told that, he said, I'm going to put enmity between your seed and her seed. That's what he was saying. You're never going to love you. You're going to hate. You're going to hate everything about the saints, everything about God, everything that has to do with him. There's going to be enmity between you two. So, and that's what he did. But you understand me. Mm-hmm. There you go. Got it? Enmity. Hate. A curse of the translation of, and I'll read it here again because it doesn't have the full, it's E-B-H-A-H. I will put enmity between thee and the woman and between thy seed and her seed. As defined by vocabulary.com, enmity means intense hostility and comes from the same Latin root as enemy. It means the state of being an enemy. If you have always hated someone, you have a history of enmity with that person. Enmity is stronger than antagonism, or is stronger than animosity. Because antagonism and animosity, what they do when you have antagonism or animosity against another person, what really it is more of a competition nature. Like, I'm going to get you, well, you did this thing, well, I'm going to do this to you. That's animosity and antagonism, but it hasn't reached the enemy yet. It hasn't gone that far yet. It's anger between one another, but it's not hatred. Do you understand what I'm saying? When you have when you have enmity, you've got hatred. When you've got hatred, it's like you murdered. Because hate means murder. So we don't want to have that. We don't have enmity is stronger than antagonism or animosity, which implies competitive feelings, but doesn't go all the way to enemy status. Hopefully, you are a peacemaker and don't experience too much enmity in your life. Hopefully, Lord willing, don't have any hatred to anybody, because if you have hatred to anybody and unforgiveness, Father God cannot see you. Father God does not see. You could be donating thousands of dollars to the church, feeding the hungry, doing everything that you think the Word says for you to do. But if you hate one person, all that you've done is for nothing, because He has not seen it. So we cannot allow hatred in our life. So we know that there's going to be enmity in this world for anyone that's a believer. We know that the world hates God. The world hates Christians. The world doesn't hate religion. The world loves religion. But the world hates Christianity. Because Christianity is a relationship with God. Religion is law instead of rules. And that's not who God is. What does the Bible say about love? The Bible gives many examples of love. We have a caring provision, like Boaz and Ruth. Remember the story of Boaz and Ruth? He cared for her. She was out there working. She was Naomi's daughter-in-law. Her husband had died. They were just them two by themselves. She went out and she worked for her, to support her mother-in-law. And Boaz saw her, fell in love with her, and he became her provider. So we have that kind of love, the caring provision love. We also have the deep friendship love, like David and Jonathan. They loved each other. Like my buddy Rose and I, we love each other. And you know what? I'm going to tell you something. How do you know that you have a best friend? You know how I know that I have a best friend? Because a best friend knows every fault of mine, every character flaw, every bad thing that I do, and she's still there. That's a best friend. When you have a friend like that, you're rich. And I pray that you do have a friend like that. I know I do. So that is a deep friendship type of love. There's the poetic, passionate love like Solomon and the Shulamite woman. And woo, you got to get into that book. Yay. It's a good book. And that's a passionate type of love, like a husband and a wife. We also have the love, the enduring commitment, like Hosea and Gomer. Have you seen the book of Hosea, the movie, the book of Hosea? Oh, my gosh, I cried. I cried at the end of that movie because, you know, Gomer, Pastor Charlie taught a little bit on it, I think, last Sunday. Gomer, she became a prostitute, and she was prostituting herself all over the place. And Hosea, he went at the end, when they put it out to market, she wasn't even worth a penny. No one would even pay a penny for her. And you would see that she was all messed up because she was a prostitute. And back in those days, she was worth not even a penny. And Hosea went and he picked her up in his arms and he took her home. She was worth a lot to him. That made me cry. You have that type of love, commitment type of love. And that's the kind of commitment that a woman and a husband should have. Love covers a multitude of sins. We have a fatherly love, like Paul for Timothy. Paul wrote two letters to Timothy. And the first one was Timothy, the church was growing a great deal, and he was a young pastor. And he was having all these questions, and, you know, the church is growing. What am I going to do? How do I do this? And Paul would write to him to comfort him and strengthen him and encourage him. And then later, the second letter, the church was dwindling. They wanted to go back to the world. They wanted to go back to the law. The church was dwindling, and he was having a lot of troubles. And Paul went ahead, and he would tell him, son. He would address him as son, and he would encourage him and tell him, hang in there, don't give up, you hang in there, you know, and that is the fatherly love. The same thing as I would do for you guys, for the ones that are younger than me, I love you like a mama, and the ones that are my age and above, I love you like a sister, and that type of love. There also is a love of the beloved John has for the church. There's an evangelistic type of love that you love the people, you love them. And of course, the sacrificial, saving love of Christ for the elect. And we know that that is the best love. The Bible has a great deal to say about love. In 1 John 4, 7, and 8, love is of God. And God is love. Love is the fundamental characteristic of who God is. Everything God does is impelled and influenced by His love. No wonder Satan hates love. Satan hates love. He hates love. What does love have to do with it? The Bible says that God was motivated by love to save the world. in John 3:16, what does he say? For God so loved the world that he what? He gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. I want to share something with you. But I'm going to share from my heart. This lesson came about because when we were praying, and I was praying to my Father, and we have music, and we're praying with the music, and I was praying, and I was worshiping him in song, and I was telling him how much I loved him. And I felt in my heart that Father was questioning my love. And it hurt me a little bit that he would do that. I felt in my heart him asking me, do you really love me? I was puzzled by the question because I know I love him. He must know I love him because he knows my heart. So I asked him, Father, if you're questioning me, I'm telling you, I love you with all my heart, and you're questioning my love for you, then I must not know what love is. So what is love? What does it look like then? I need to know. I need to know because I want to love you right. Right? And that's what I was questioning. And that's how this lesson came about. Because I want to know, what's love? What's love got to do with it? What does it look like? And I even questioned my sisters, what do you think love looks like? So I pose the question to you. What does love look like? What does your love for him look like? I want you to ponder this as we go through this lesson. Because you say, well, I know what love looks like. Okay, keep it, we'll go back to it. But then think, what does your love for him look like? Ponder that. Does it look like this? Sacrificial? Does it look like, are you going through something like that? Do you feel like you're going through something like that? Maybe it looks like that. The weight is too heavy for you to carry. Maybe you can't get up anymore. Maybe you kind of, that's it. I can't move from here. Maybe it's like that. You're giving it all you've got. Help me, Lord! What does love look like? Is it sacrifice? Does it look like that? Does it look like, I don't know anymore. I can't go anymore. What does your love look like? What does love look like? Abraham sacrificed his son. I want to show you this. This is the most actual picture of the crucifixion. If you could see where his head is, I do have a pointer. I think it's this one. Let me see. Which one is the pointer? This one here. If you could see, oh, you can't because it's red. If you could see where his head at, you could see where his beard is, because he's like this. You could see all this where they yank his beard out. Just around it, you could see his lips. You could see a little bit of his nose. You could see a little bit of his eyebrow. But because of the way that he was beaten, whipped, when he was raised up like that, the people could not recognize him as a man because he didn't look like a man. He looked like raw flesh,
hanging on that post, on that cross. Right there on the side is a description of a doctor that described, I can't read it from here, but it describes what literally happened to him on the cross. When the nails went through his wrist, it sent a fire, excruciating fire, all the way up his arms, up to his brain, down to his spine, down to his legs. It would jerk him, and he would lift up, and then his legs would cramp. And it, I'm going to tell you something, sisters. Why, Leonor, are you showing us this? Why, Leonor, are you giving this picture to us? Why do I want the others to see? Because I don't want you to take his death lightly. He didn't go, it wasn't an easy trip skipping down the Via Dolorosa. It was the Via Dolorosa, painful. And we've seen, Easter's coming up pretty soon. We seem to forget what he went through. We have to remember. We have to remember so that our hearts can be moved, because our hearts are getting hard. Our hearts are getting hard. We're becoming desensitized. We're becoming desensitized through what Jesus went through. Each generation that passes by, each generation that goes by gets colder and colder and colder. So when Jesus comes, how many faithful ones is he going to find? Because why? We're losing our faith. We don't understand. We can't comprehend. We don't know what it is like. But that's why I'm doing this, so you could get a little glimpse, a tiny, tiny glimpse of what could have been. I wasn't there. We weren't there. A lot of people weren't there. But don't forget that it wasn't a pie through the, right through the park for Jesus. He did this. Why? Was it love? Or was it sacrifice? Really? We'll see. We could say it was a sacrifice, but I'm going to take you back to a pivot point, and you're going to say, oh. Abraham sacrificed his son. In Genesis 22, 9 and 10, I'm going to read it to you. And they came to a place of which God had told Abraham to go. What did God ask Abraham to do? To sacrifice his son. That was a sacrifice. And Abraham built an altar, and placed the wood in order. And he bound Isaac, his son, and laid him on the altar upon the wood. And Abraham stretched out his hand and took the knife to slay his son. Is that what love looks like? Sacrifice? Back then? And now? Ours? What are we thinking we're sacrificing for the Lord? What are we thinking we're sacrificing? Is it getting up and getting dressed and coming to church? Is that a sacrifice? Is it opening the Bible and sitting down, drinking a cup of coffee, and reading the Word? Is that a sacrifice? Is it opening your devotions and reading a devotion? Okay, I'm done. I've done my duty. Is that a sacrifice? That's nothing, ladies. Compared, nothing. Right? Do you agree with me? I agree. But Father is not interested in sacrifice. He's not interested in sacrifice. Let's get into the Word. Turn to 1 Samuel chapter 15. And we're going to pick up at verse 13. And we're going to read through 28. Saul is on a downward slide of disobedience, and the prophet Samuel is frustrated with this man he anointed as king. 1 Samuel, chapter 15, verses 13 through 28. Tell me when you're there. Okay. Are we ready? I'll give you guys a little time to get there. The Lord had asked Saul to go and kill all the Amalekites. Everything. Everyone. Dogs, cats, cows. Everything. Everything that they possessed. That was the instruction the Lord gave Saul. The prophet that was in Saul's time was Samuel. So, Saul went. He did what he was supposed to do according to Saul. And he was waiting for Samuel. So here comes Samuel, verse 13. When Samuel came near to Saul, Saul greeted him and said, this is what Saul said. This is so funny. The Lord bless you. I have obeyed the Lord's commands. But Samuel said, then what is that sound I hear? Why do I hear sheep and cattle? He was supposed to have destroyed everything. So, why do I hear sheep? Why am I hearing cattle if you're supposed to, if you did everything the Lord told you to do? Right? Saul said, the soldier, and then Saul, the king, said, the soldiers took them from the Amalekites. They saved the best sheep and cattle to burn as sacrifice to the Lord your God. He didn't say to the Lord our God. He said to the Lord your God. But we destroyed everything else. Samuel said to Saul, the prophet said to Saul, stop. Before he went on, before Saul continued to go, Samuel said, stop. Sometimes you have to stop people. When you know that they're trying to give you a runaround, when you know that the enemy is trying to say, wait, stop. Don't go any further. Let me tell you what the Lord told me. And this is what Samuel said, stop. Let me tell you what the Lord told me last night. And Saul, King Saul answered, tell me, what did he say? And he still didn't get it. He said, tell me, what did he say? And Samuel said, in the past, you didn't think that you were important, but the Lord chose you to be king. So you became the leader of the tribe of Israel. The Lord, and notice Lord is all capital. This is the Father. The Lord sent you on a special mission. He said, go and destroy all the Amalekites. They are evil people. Destroy them all. Fight them until they are completely finished or completely destroyed. So why didn't you listen to the Lord? You did what the Lord said is wrong because you wanted to keep what you took in battle. So he said, I get what the Lord said. And that was taking the cattle, the best ones. But he didn't do it because of the Lord told him. He did it because he wanted them for himself. Saul said, but I did obey the Lord. He was still arguing to the prophet. But I did obey the Lord. I'm going to tell you something, ladies. If you know someone that's maturer than you in the Lord, don't argue with them when they try and tell you something. Because there's no way that you're going to get ahead of them. They've been living longer than you. Respect that. Respect your overseers. Don't cause him anything to complain to the Lord about for you. But he said, I did obey the Lord. I went where the Lord sent me. I destroyed all the Amalekites. I brought back only one, their king. Can you believe it? He went and he destroyed all and brought back the king. Oh my gosh. Oh, does that sound human or what? And the soldiers took the best sheep and cattle to sacrifice to the Lord, your God, at Gilgal. But Samuel answered, which pleases the Lord more, burnt offerings and sacrifice, or obeying his commandments? It is better to obey the Lord than to offer sacrifice to him. It is better to listen to him than to offer the fat of the rams. What was the title that was given to Jesus when he comes back that we're going to see? The Word. The Word. Remember? We are to listen to the Word. Obey the Word. Because he is the Word. Are you understanding what I'm saying? It is better to listen to him than to offer the fat from the rams. Refusing to obey is as bad as the sin of sorcery. When you know that the Word is telling you something, and you go ahead and do it anyway, and you don't listen to that little spirit speaking inside of you, that little voice, you're doing sorcery. It's not so sweet to him. Being stubborn and doing what you want is like the sin of worshiping idol. Who's the idol? You? Me? When we do things that we want to do, instead of doing what the Lord says, it's like worshiping yourself. It's like worshiping myself. Did you know that? You refuse to obey the Lord's command, so he now refuses to accept you as king. Uh-oh. He's going to be demoted. And who wants to be demoted? Uh-uh. The king has too much authority and too much power and too much. He never wanted to go of that. So what does Saul do? Then Saul said to Samuel, I have sinned. I did not obey the Lord's command. And I did not do what the Lord told me. I was afraid of the people. Now he's blaming the people. I was afraid of the people and I did what they said. Now I beg you, forgive me for doing this thing. Come back with me so I may worship the Lord. But Samuel said to Saul, the prophet said to the king, I won't go back with you. You rejected the Lord's command, and now the Lord rejects you. You as king of Israel. When Samuel turned to leave, Saul caught Samuel's robe, and the robe tore. Samuel said to Saul, in this same way the Lord has torn your kingdom from Israel. Of Israel from you today. He has given the kingdom to one of your friends, a man who is a better person than you. What did Samuel do wrong? I mean, we could see it right there. Samuel was thinking of Samuel. Saul was thinking of Saul, the king. I'm sorry, King Saul was thinking of King Saul. He was doing what he wanted to do. You know, one of the things that you could tell a leader, years ago I took courses of leadership. You had to take courses of leadership in order to do any type of work in the church I was going to. And you had to take 2 months of leadership courses. And you got certified for it. So I went ahead and took it because I right away wanted it. Got busy right away. So I took it. And one of the most important things of a leader is this. In order for you to be a leader, you must submit. You must be able to take instructions. You cannot add or subtract from those instructions. You are to follow them to the T. When a supervisor gives you an instruction, you do what they ask you to do. You don't do what you feel to do or what you know to do. Even if you think you know more than they do, you don't do that. That's not leadership. That is the spirit of Saul. That is not leadership quality. Because a person like that has no teachable spirit. You can't teach a person that doesn't have a teachable spirit. They're not humble. They do things their way. You could tell them, okay, I want you to do this, this, and this, and this. And they either, when you go, they either do it their way, they add, or they subtract, they do what they feel. That is very wrong. That person has no business in leadership because they don't know how to submit. In order for you to become a leader, you must submit. Or else you're not going to be respected. No one's going to want you. You're going to lose job after job after job because you don't respect the supervisor. You know what I'm saying? So part of being a leader is learning to submit whether you think you are right or you think you are wrong. Whatever the purpose, you do what they ask you to do. When you're in charge, then you could do. But don't take it upon yourself to do anything. You do what you're asked to do. That's a high quality of a teachable spirit. I learned that the hard way, but I learned it. The hard way, but I learned it. So the key is to learn it. So Saul, Saul just did things his way. Saul chose to keep the Amalekite king Agag alive and took the plunder in the battle rather than to destroy everything as God had commanded. He did what he wanted. When Samuel confronted him, Saul said, I did obey the Lord. And and that's what they say. When you say, why did you do? Oh, well, I did what you wanted me to. But I did it my way. I went on the mission the Lord assigned me. He said, I did it. I completely destroyed the Amalekites and brought back Agag, their king. So how does that completely fit in if he brought back the king? Completely means totally. The soldiers took sheep and cattle from the plunder, the best of what was devoted to God, in order to sacrifice them to the Lord, your God, at Gilgal. He never said the Lord was his God. Samuel answered, does the Lord delight in burnt offerings and sacrifice as much as in obeying the Lord? To obey is better than sacrifice. Why is obedience better than sacrifice? Remember Samuel's response? For rebellion is like sin of divination. That's why obedience is better than sacrifice. To obey is better than sacrifice. Because when you obey, you're doing exactly what you're told to do. You're not going against it. You are doing what you are told. You're being submissive. You're being humble, and you're being submissive. And arrogance is like the evil of idolatry. And doing it your way, it's a little bit of arrogance. Let's just say it like it is. It's arrogance. Like the evil idolatry. Because you have rejected the word of the Lord, he has rejected you as king. Saul's disobedience was an act of rebellion. It was an act of iniquity, sin, and idolatry. He said, I have sinned. I violated the Lord's command and your instructions. I was afraid of the man and of the men, so I gave in to them. That was a lie. Saul admitted that his sacrifice was a transgression, sin, and was against God's command. It was the result of seeking the approval of the people. Putting it all together, we see several reasons why disobedience to God is better. Obedience to God is better than making sacrifice or offerings to him. Disobedience is an act of rebellion. It's sinful. It is a form of idolatry. Disrespect God's word. And disobedience is based on looking good to other people rather than to God. We don't have to look like we know it all. We don't have to look like I got everything under control. Thank God that all you have to do is take one look at me and you know what a mess I am. still today, in our human attempts to look good in serving God, and you could do it in many different ways. You could, like I said, you could do it in even trying to do good things for the Lord, and still it's wrong because what is the motive of the heart? Still today, in our human attempts to look good in serving God, there is a temptation to perform certain religious duties rather than truly obey God. Even good activities such as giving money to charity, attending church services, or praying in public are not as important to God as obeying His commands. Jesus criticized the teachers of His time in similar practices. They had religious activities, fasting, public prayer, and giving to those in need, even that. Because they would go in front of people. They'd make sure there was people around so that people could see and hear. Oh, here you go. Here you go. The food is free. The food is free. Oh, you did a, oh, you're so wonderful. Oh, you're so giving. Oh, you're this and that. Oh, it makes them feel good. We're doing God's will. He will righteous. No, that's all you're going to get. I don't want a pat on the back and say, oh, no, you're doing good. I want His blessing. That's the blessing I want. I want His blessing. And you should not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing. Right? So, are we hearing this? That people often use to look good in front of other people rather than to honor God. When Abraham was going, when Abraham was going to slay his son Isaac, father wasn't interested in the sacrifice. He was as he was in obedience. What happened? In Genesis 22:11-12, father God saw, he told him, he gave him instruction. Look at the instruction that he gave him. I want you to take your son to the mount. I want you to go up and I want you to sacrifice him to me. He could have done, tried to get out of it, but he didn't. He went ahead and did it. And look at what happened, because he was obedient. But the angel of the Lord called to him, to him from heaven and said, Abraham, Abraham. So he said, here I am. And he said, do not lay your hand on the lad or do anything to him. For now I know that you fear God. That's a good kind of fear. That's a good kind of fear. Because Abraham feared God. He didn't fear God that, oh my gosh, he's going to do something to me. If I don't do it, he's going to do it. No. He feared that if he didn't do it because God had promised him a nation of children. So he said, I'm not going to do anything to mess up that promise. Nothing. So if he tells me to do this, I'm going to do it because I trust him that he's going to fulfill his word. I trust him that he's going to be faithful. Ladies, we need to trust the word of God. We need to trust that when he says, don't worry, I'm taking care of your children, he's doing it. There's no need for you to worry. When you have a problem, you give it to him. Don't dwell on it. No, trust the word. The word, know that he is more than able, more than capable. He is faithful. He's going to fulfill his word. But we have to believe that he is. And that he has no control of, because we have free choice. It's our choice. Are we going to believe? Yes. If we say yes, yes, Lord. It's hard for me to believe, but I'm going to believe. So I'm erasing it from my mind because I'm trusting you. And believe. That's believe. Trusting. And Abraham trusted God that he was going to fulfill his word. Trust that he's going to take care of your children. Trust that he's going to take care of your grandchildren. Trust him. I know it's easy for us as humans to say, well, you know I'm human, and you know as humans we... No, stop saying that. That's a cop-out. Stop saying, well, you know, it's going to take time, little by little, I'm learning. No. That's because that's what you want. You want to justify. Either you trust or you don't. Why am I saying this? Because I want you to trust. Because I want you to learn to trust. You're not going to learn to trust if you tell me, well, I'm learning. Okay, all right, God knows you. Okay. No, no. I want to tell you, no, stop that. Believe. Trust him. He is the word. When he comes down riding on the horse, we're going to see his title, the word. And when he comes down from heaven, we're going to see the word. Oh, my gosh. I didn't trust it. The word. Oh, no. I heard it. But I was growing. It's not going to cut it. It's not going to cut it. Trust it. Just trust it. Try it. You like it. It's good. It's good. I'm not trying to be pushy. I'm trying to tell you the truth. I'm trying to tell you the truth because I love you. And I don't want to see you defeated by the enemy. I don't want that. I don't want it. So the only thing I can see is the next time you only have, only probably have one here, but that's okay if only one is willing to hear the truth. If one is willing to hear the truth, I'm here for you. Oh, my God. I'm going to tell you something. I'm telling you this because that is what he told me. Trust me, Leonor. And I'm saying, Lord, how? I'll show you how. I'll show you how. What does love look like? How do I prove I love you? How do I prove I love you? By trusting him. In Genesis 22:11-12. Oh, I already read that. Dear God, since you have not withheld your son, your only son from me. There was a reason why he was obedient, because he trusted him. The greatest illustration of this love, of this, is Jesus Christ himself. As it says in Philippians 2:8, saying, and being found in human form, he humbled. There's no pride in that. He humbled, teachable spirit, himself in becoming obedient. When you are obedient to instructions and follow them to the T, you are being humble. You are being humble. You are being obedient. And Jesus was humble and obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross. Because what? When he was saying, if we go back to the picture, when he was saying, forgive me, Lord. I mean, when he was saying, Lord, if there's any other way, he said, not my will, but your will. Not my will, but your will. He said, I want to be obedient to you and do what you tell me to do no matter what. I'm going to go. I'm going to do it. Why? Because I love you. The love that he has for his father is the same kind of love that he wants us to have for him. Amen? So what does love look like? What does love have to do with it? Let's look at Luke. Is it sacrifice or obedience? I'm taking you to several places because I want to show you things. In Luke chapter 22, verse 39-44. I'm going to read it to you in the King James Version. That's the one I read most of the time. And here we're going to talk about the account where he just was going out to the Mount of Olives. And you're going to say, that one again? Yes, ma'am. Absolutely. Are we there? Luke 22, chapter 22. And the verses is going to be 39-44. I want to show you some things in this verse, in this group of scriptures. Are we there? Coming out, he went to the Mount of Olives, as he was accustomed, and his disciples also followed him. When he came to the place, he said to them, pray that you may not enter into temptation. And the temptation was because they were tired, and he wanted them to pray because Jesus knew that the time had come, that he was going to be arrested. So he told them, I want you to pray for me. Pray for me. I want you to pray for me. He said, don't fall into temptation. I was, don't fall asleep. Don't abandon me. Pray for me. So he said, so that you will enter into temptation, verse 41. And he was withdrawn from them about a stone's throw from here, when he threw a stone that far away. And he knelt down and prayed. I want to show you something. And he knelt down and prayed, saying, Father. Now, to me right here, it doesn't look like he's just... This picture right here, I don't see that. I see he is praying. He is giving a fervent prayer. A fervent prayer. And he said, Father, if it is your will, take this cup away from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. Then an angel appeared to him from heaven, strengthening him. Can you imagine the state that he was in when he was praying that an angel had to come down to strengthen him? Did you ever think of that? We just see him praying, the pretty little picture like that, and he's just praying. No. No. Far from it. He was agonizing. He was praying fervently to the point that an angel came down to strengthen him. Wow! To strengthen the Son of God. The Son of God Almighty, listen to me. It was not a walk in the park. And being in agony, he prayed more earnestly. Then he sweat. He prayed earnestly. Oh, that's beautiful. Look at that. I didn't even know that did that. Is it doing that over there, what you're watching?
Oh, that's beautiful. Thank you, Lord. Oh, that's gorgeous. The angel is strengthening him. Wow. Then his sweat became like great drops of blood. Falling down to the ground. They became light. And there is a doctor, and I didn't bring it, but there is a doctor that explains what happened to him in the agonizing moment. And it says that when that happens, when people agonize so much like that, that their vessels that break and it separates the water from it, and it's blood that comes out through the pores. But you have to be in extreme agonizing to do that. That's real. Here is the proof Jesus left for the Father. That even though he knew, Jesus knew what was going to happen and what he was going to go through, he loved agape. What's the agape love? What does agape love mean? Agape. Unconditional love. That's the kind of love, remember, that the Father has for us, unconditional. Unconditional love. Jesus loved agape, the Father, that he obeyed him unto death. Unconditional, no matter what. Does my love look like that? Does your love look like that? And that's what he's saying. I want you to love me unconditional. Because if we love him unconditional, that means that he can trust us to do whatever he tells us to do. Why? Because we love him unconditionally. If he tells us, I want you to do, oh no, I can't. You see, I have to be home to feed my husband. I want you to, oh, no. Well, you see, well, I got to do this because of my kids, Lord. I got to take care of my kids. No. He wants us to love him unconditional. He knows your responsibilities. Do you think he's going to ask you to do something that's going to contradict his own word? No. Of course not. But he wants you to love him unconditionally. What does love have to do with it? Obedience or sacrifice? What does our love look like? Remember, he said obedience is better than sacrifice. As I was reading the three different accounts of this theme right here, I came across something that seemed way out of place, and I want to share it with you. See, this account, it's in all the four Gospels. And each one, there's a little difference in each one because they're different people. So, I was looking at Mark. And in Mark, in verse 41, he's talking about, you know, when Jesus came out and told the disciples to stay awake. He came out and told them to stay awake. To not go to sleep. And then he went back to pray and agonize. And then he came back out and found them asleep again. And he woke them up again. I said, stay awake. Can't you stay awake not even for an hour? And he went back and agonized some more. And then he came back the third time and they were asleep. And he told them, are you still sleeping and resting? It's enough. The hour has come. Behold, the Son of Man is being betrayed into the hands of the sinners. He said, that's it. It's done. It's going to happen right now. I'm being betrayed right this moment. And
As I continued to read, I pick up on verse 46, where it says, "Then they laid their hands on him and took him." And there's so much I wish I could tell you, and I want to eventually tell you everything. "And one of those who stood by drew the sword and struck the servant. Then Jesus answered and said to them, Have you come out as against a robber with swords and clubs to take me? I was daily with you in the temple teaching, and you did not seize me, but the scriptures must be fulfilled. Then they took and forsook him and fled." So all this, it has to do with what we're talking about. But then this two verses came out, and I said, what in the world is this? And they are 51 and 52. "Now, a certain young man followed him, having linen cloth thrown around his naked body. And the young man laid on him, and he, laid on him, and he left the linen cloth and fled away from them naked." Okay, what does that have to do with anything? Right? It does. And there's a lot of controversy on this. Now, I don't think anyone really knows for sure why this verse was injected here, other than to show and prove that Jesus was the I Am, the life giver itself. And for that, I went to the Gospel of John to look at the same event. And if you want to turn to John 18, 4 and 6, you'll find it there. In the garden, he was praying just as he had done, that he was done praying. There Jesus, therefore, when he had told them, okay, it's done, it's over, they're coming for me right now, knowing all things that would come upon him, went forward and said to them, "Who are you seeking?" Because the soldiers were already coming. And let me tell you something about the soldiers. That it says that there was a banner, a battalion of soldiers. Do you know that there's 300 to 1,000 to 1,300 soldiers in one banner, one battalion? So can you imagine, say it was at least 300. 300 soldiers came along with the high priest and the Pharisees to arrest Jesus, one man, with torches and clubs and fire to arrest just one man. That's how many came to just arrest one man. He said, "Whom are you seeking?" And they answered him, "Jesus of Nazareth." Then Jesus said to them, "I am he." Wow. And Judas, who betrayed him, also stood with him. Now, when he said to them, "I am he," the soldiers drew back and fell on the ground. I want you to picture this. You know, a nuclear bomb when it's hit, or an atom bomb when it's hit, it blooms and then it shoots out radiation. Jesus, the life-giving power and force, when he said, "I am," that word "I am" is the same "I am" that he said to Moses, "Tell them that I am sent you." It's the same "I am." And let me tell you something else. This is exciting to me. I get goosey. Okay. Oh, I'm sorry, I'm being live. Anyway, now, look at what it says, this commentator. I loved it. "Furthermore, we think that the garden was in a mount, which it was, but guess what our mind, simple mind, sees the mount, a big mount, and they were in the bottom of the mountain. And that was it. No. No. It was a large piece of land, a huge piece of land. And it said, furthermore, the Garden of Gethsemane was situated on the side of the Mount of Olives. Toward the base of the mount is a heavily populated cemetery, with many of its graves going back to the time of Jesus. So in other words, when Jesus was there on the mount, there was a huge cemetery that was close to the area where he was at. And they were burying the people there. The custom back then to bury them is they would wash their bodies clean, and they would leave them naked because they're going to bury them, and they would wrap them in linen. And they'd bury them. So, toward the base of the mount is heaven from the cemetery, with many of its graves going back to the time of Jesus, when Jesus said, I am. The power that was released was so tremendous that it knocked the soldiers backward, but eventually it also caused a rumbling in the local cemetery. Well, it said that that man was following Jesus. He must have been what the scholars think, and a lot of commentators think, that he must have been someone that they had just buried. And when Jesus said, I am, the force and the energy went out, and the man, boom, came back to life. And what is the life, the energy, the life that that man had? Well, it was seeking the life giver. It was following the life giver. He was following Jesus. Oh, my gosh. Are you listening to me? Oh, my goodness. Please don't tell me that there is no God. Oh. Oh. So, let us come to a conclusion. What does love have to do with it? What does our love look like? Let's get the answer from Peter. Since that is where Jesus built the church, on that, the church that hell will not prevail against. Peter said, remember, Peter said he loved Jesus so much he would die for him. But instead of dying for him, he denied him three times. What does love have to do with it? Let's go to Matthew 29, chapter 29, verses 69 to 75. I'm going to read it. Week of time. Matthew chapter 26. Chapter 26. Verses 69 to 75. Now, here's the account where Jesus was already taken. And, of course, Peter was following him from afar, like everybody else was. Right? We all know that account, so it's good. Are we there? Okay. Now, and verse 69, now Peter sat outside the courtyard, and his servant girl came to him, saying, you also were with Jesus of Galilee. But he denied it before them all. Now, let me remind you a little bit. Remember when Jesus, when Peter was telling Jesus, I'll never deny you. I'll die for you. And Jesus said, before this evening is over, you're going to deny me three times. I'm going to die for you. So this is what happened. So he sat outside, and then the servant girl came to him and said, you also were with Jesus of Galilee. Verse 70. But he denied it before them all, saying, I do not know what you are saying. And when he had gone out to the gateway, another girl saw him and said to those who were there, this fellow also was with Jesus of Nazareth. And again he denied it with an oath. I do not know the man. And a little later, those who stood by came up and said to Peter, surely you also are the one of them, for your speech betrays you, because he was a Galilean. Then he began to curse and swear, saying, I do not know the man. Immediately, a rooster crowed. And Peter remembered the word of Jesus, who had said to him, before the rooster crows, you will deny me three times. So he went out and wept bitterly. In another account, I think it's Mark, or was it Luke, where he denied him, Jesus turned around and looked at him. And Peter looked at Jesus, and what could he have thought? Wow. And he went and he cried. Three times he denied him. Now, are we going to deny him? We deny him certain different ways. We're not going to say, no, we're not, because we deny him in different ways. So we go to the store, we deny him in certain things. Maybe we don't pray or say, bless you, but if you are honest in your heart and you search your heart, there are certain times where we're put in a position where we don't say anything, we're kept silent. That's a form of denial. So he cried and he went. They crucified the Lord. And after he had risen again, after the Lord had risen again, many people saw him. I went to John chapter 21, verses 15 to 17. And Peter said, I want to go fishing. Time had passed. Yeah, I want to go fishing. Let's do something. Let's go do something. So they went out to fish. And while they were out there, they came close to the shore, and they saw a man on the shore. And the man said, hey, guys, have you caught any fish? And they said, no, not really. He said, well, throw the net on this side. And he threw the net on that side. And they caught a lot of fish. So then they got closer. And then one of them said, oh, my goodness, that's the Lord. And Peter put on his garment and he jumped in the water. Peter did the first one and jumped in water and started swimming to him. And he got there and he said, he didn't say nothing. Then the other disciples came and he dragged the fish, and Jesus was cooking the fish and making breakfast. So let's pick up on verse 15. So when they had eaten breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me more than these? And this is what reminded me when I asked the Lord, when I felt the Lord telling me, do you love me? And I said, what do you mean, Lord? This is where I got it from. It's it. Do you love me more than these? He said to him, yes, Lord. You know I love you. Then Jesus said to him, feed my lambs. He said to him again the second time, Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me? And he said to him, yes, Lord. You know I love you. And he said to him, tend my sheep. He said to him the third time, Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me? Peter was grieved because he said to him the third time, "Do you love me?" And he said to him, "Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you." And Jesus said to him, "Feed my sheep." Let me tell you a little bit of what I found out on this. The first time he said, "Feed my lambs." What's the difference between a sheep and lambs? What are the difference between them? The lamb is a baby. And he said, "Feed my baby," the newborn Christian. "Feed my baby." The third time he said, "Tend my sheep." What does tend mean? Take care. Take care of one another. He said, "Take care of the church. Because on you I'm going to build this church." Remember? On this, when Peter said, "You are the Son of the living God," he said, "On this I'm going to build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it." So he said, "On you I'm going to build my church." So feed my, tend my sheep. Take care of them. And then he said, "Feed my sheep." You're not only going to take care of them, but you're also going to instruct them. You're also going to give them the word. You're also going to take care of them. And I felt that he was telling me, "You're going to feed my lambs. They're going to tend my sheep. And you're going to feed my sheep." If I come strong, if I come across strong, if I come across, it, because I have to do what he tells me to do. I have to do it. And you're so important to me. Each one of you, I don't see so much the outside as I see the light inside. Your soul. And you're being sought after by the enemy. And I don't want the enemy to catch you off guard. That's why I teach. And Father God said, "Do you love me, Leonor, this much that you will go through whatever you have to go through to do what I'm asking you to do? Feed my sheep, tend my lambs, feed my lambs, tend my sheep, feed my sheep." And he's saying the same thing to you. He's saying the same thing to you. He doesn't want you just sitting around doing anything. You have a gift. And that gift, he gave it to you so you could use it for his kingdom, whatever it may be. I got Myrna's permission to use her as an example. You know what she does? She doesn't announce it to the world. She doesn't announce it so other people could see. She goes, "Leonor, I got something for you." And she goes to the car and brings you a bag, whatever. That's a blessing. I love it. It's a blessing. She doesn't announce it. She goes, "No, that's a gift." She serves. She cooks. She bakes. And she doesn't announce it to the world. And she doesn't wait for me to call and say thank you. If I don't call and go say thank you, she doesn't get hurt. I do. But she doesn't get hurt if I don't. Right? Mama? She won't get hurt. So, there is a difference. He wants you to use your gift. He wants you to be useful in his kingdom. There is also an interesting contrast when you look at the Greek words for love used in John. When Jesus asked Peter, "Do you love me?" When Jesus asked Peter, "Do you love me?" in John 21, 15, and 16, he used the Greek word agape. When Jesus asked Peter, when he was cooking for them breakfast, and he said, "Simon Peter, do you love me?" He was saying, "Do you agape me?" Not phileo. agony. And Peter said, yes, Lord, I phileo you. When Peter said, yes, Lord, I love you, he didn't use the word agape. He used the word love for phileo, friendship, brotherly love. He said, Peter responded with, yes, Lord, you know I love you, using the Greek word phileo, which refers more to a brotherly friendship type of love. It seems that Jesus is trying to get Peter to understand that he must love Jesus unconditionally in order to be the leader God is calling him to be. In order for you to succeed in doing whatever it is that you want to do, that God has put in your heart to do, that is a gift, you need to love him agape, so that you can be able to do it. Because if you don't love him agape, that means there's other things in front of him. He doesn't come first. There's other things in front of him. So you must agape him in order to fulfill your destiny on earth. You must agape him, no matter what. The third time Jesus asked, do you love me? He uses the word phileo again. And Peter again responds with the Lord, using the same phileo. You know that I love you. What does love have to do with it? Father God is love. Obedience to him is your proof of love to the Father. Did you know that? Obedience to his word, obedience to the word, obedience to the word is your proof that you love him. Do you love me? Do you agape me? Are you going to do whatever it takes to do my will? Are you going to do whatever I ask you to do? The only way that you can do it and be obedient like that is if you agape him. Because nothing stands there. Nothing. He is first. Obedience to his word is proof to him how much you love him. When Abraham was going to slay Isaac, it was proof to him how much he loved him. When Jesus, his son, died on the cross, it was proof to him that his son loved him. When Saul disobeyed, it was proof to him that he didn't love him. Right? Are you understanding what I'm saying? We must be obedient to his word. It is enough. Behold, the hour is now. Wake up. We know the hour is late and we feel tired. But let us not fall into temptation and spiritually fall asleep. He's telling us that today. Listen. Wake up, Leonor. Be alert. Yes, get to work. He's coming back. He's coming back. In his timing, he's coming back. We're about to hear the trumpet. Jesus is getting up from his throne, coming in all his glory. In all his glory. In all his glory. Oh, my goodness. He is coming on a cloud. Joy with so much joy. Joyous would be that day when he comes with all his angels. And we are going to be among them to welcome him back. He is coming on a cloud. What a joyous day that will be. Let's be obedient so we can be included with those that will meet him and greet him on his coming. What's love got to do with it? Look. See. He is love. He is love. What's got love got to do with it? What's love got to do with it? Proof. Agape is the proof of how much you love him. And I pray, Lord, I pray, my Father, that your word has gone forth, that we had ears to listen, and that we know a little bit more now, and that we understand a little bit better what it is you're asking us, what it is you're expecting of us. You want us to love you unconditionally, so that we can have the strength to move and do what it is you have given us to do here on this earth. We were not put here just because to make the world more beautiful. We were put here to finish the work that Jesus gave us to do. We are your people. We proclaim you as our Lord. We are not ashamed of the name of Jesus. He is love, so we are love. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Jesus, that you're still interceding for us. Thank you, Father, for making a way. In Jesus' name we pray and we say, amen and amen.